Let's get into the Wednesday Wrangle with Sky News host Liz Storer here on the set with me, but we're missing Justin Smith speaking in, jumping into the fray, though, is Christy McSweeney again. Great to have you on board again, Christy, for the Wednesday Wrangle. I want to talk about youth crime and these stats out today. Given there's been so much community concern, we've had all the anecdotal evidence, especially in Queensland and the Northern Territory, confirming, Christy, right around the country, youth crime is up. Something needs to be done about it.
Well, not only is youth crime up, there are less unique offenders but more crime, which means core groups of kids are committing crimes over and over again, which makes it really difficult and a real example that whatever is going on, and particularly in regional Australia, northwest of WA, places in New South Wales like Moree, communities there are sick and tired of whatever programs are given to them not working.
Yeah, it's a problem. You know, I love the expression we have in this country, she'll be right. You know, I love the fact that it means we sort of get on with things, but we seem to have a series of governments around the country. She'll be right, just let things happen. No one needs to do anything about this.
No, and so the situation is, of course, getting worse. Obviously, these stats are disproportionately represented in the Northern Territory, Queensland, but surprisingly, what I noticed in today's graph, they put up a graph of these new stats, is that Tasmania, of all places, has now suddenly spiked very quickly to match Queensland at the end of this last financial year, which is very really surprising because we don't often hear about the youth crime crisis in Tasmania. But what I don't think we talk about enough is that obviously happy, healthy kids do not engage in criminal activity. We do know that we have a mental health crisis here in this country, which is, again, disproportionately affecting our young people. They're growing up in a world that is unrecognisable, thanks to technology, unrecognisable for their parents, and the toll that that is taking on kids' mental health, how they feel about the world and their place in it. And some kids then turn to criminal activity. And again, what are state governments doing to help these kids frame a different life for themselves in which they don't feel like criminal activity is their thing anymore? We just don't see any of these practical measures taking place on a state or federal level, Chris.
It all comes back to family values and the core unit of society being the traditional family. But you say
and do
that,
we see those being upheld by local governments?
Apparently it's offensive to even talk about that. Yeah, it's outrageous. Now, look, there's a little bit of a sign in some data today, Christy, that shows you, of course, how the public have got more sense than the politicians. And it is that only 2 in 5 Australians believe that the country's going to get to these climate ambitions, net zero emissions of 2030 and 2050. It means that, Christy, while these things supposedly are politically popular, Blind Freddy can see that it ain't going to happen.
Well, what I found really interesting about the results of this poll, over 1,200 people, it's a significant sample, was that in issues that people care about unprompted, so these are things that they bring up as a concern to them in focus groups, healthcare and crime is leading as the top two unprompted concerns, ahead of any concerns they have around climate change and renewable and clean energy, primarily because people just want to pay their bills. And I think that most people are looking at the way the industry, such as the Minerals Councils of Australia, launching a significant campaign against the Labor Party, how they have not engaged properly with the automotive industry around green energy transition and saying, look, they haven't negotiated this properly with industry. And if you can't negotiate with industry to get to a resolution, you can't meet those targets unless you do it by pure stealth, which seems to be what is occurring.
Yeah, and they're all promises that are sort of 10 elections away for these people, which is why they're meaningless. It's interesting too, given we've got a cost of living crisis, of course, I noticed that Jim Chalmers, the Treasurer, is stepping back from the idea of charging EV drivers a road usage charge. I mean, he's not going to want to throw out another tax, another cost that's going to be politically unpopular. But it does mean, Liz, that apart from the tax breaks and the incentives, EV drivers get to use our roads for free, unlike the rest
of us. For free, although we don't know that that charge isn't going to come into play. We just know it's not going to into play before an election Federal Labor desperately wants to win. So this is just a ridiculous ploy, and it just goes to show how much the ruling elites take us for flogs, because you've already flagged that you intend to do this, but you won our vote, so you're not going to do it prior to an election because it may lose you some, but you've already declared your intentions. So the whole idea is that most people, which sadly is true in Australia, aren't politically alive enough to what's going on in this space to know that unless it doesn't hit their hip pocket before the election, they may place their vote differently. That's what Chalmers is counting on. And it's just so disingenuous taking Aussies for a ride like this.
Bank the free roads with your $275 power bill cut.
Oh, yeah, I can't wait.
What amuses me too, like Labor and all the other lefties, of course, they talk up all the time this climate emergency and we're all going to drown in boiling oceans and whatever, and then they wonder why they get protesters turn up here at Kirribilli saying that the Labor Party's not doing enough to save the planet, Christy. I mean, they're just reaping what they've sown here, right? You call it an emergency, well, then you want to be doing all sorts of things to supposedly save the planet.
Look, my view, Chris, is that the government and the Greens and their preference coalition are sort of like the Channel 10 of politics. The poll numbers keep slipping. We've seen these polls today on the energy targets. They're slipping in Queensland. But they're pitching to an audience that they think they've captured, which is the under 35s, where they're polling ahead. And so that's a very core constituency for them, and that's what they're pitching to. We're going to see Labor have to out-green the Greens to keep that constituency. They're going to have to speak more of emergency, and that, of course, is going to drive more people from the centre, perhaps to the coalition or to other minor parties further on the centre-right, as this tussle between Labor and the Greens of who can be the bigger hero to the under-35s in the climate emergency continues through to the next election.
I'd fix it all tomorrow by getting rid of compulsory voting, but we'll save that debate for another day. Anastasia Palaszczuk, the former Premier in Queensland, she's gone on to the Smart Energy Council. So it's just all fun and games and money to be made in this space.
Well, one could argue she's been working for the Smart Energy Council for a while now, Chris, in her role as Premier, because we know that that was a very friendly government when it comes to implementing policies that were right up these guys' alleys. So who's to say this isn't a reward for a job well done that's been being done for a great many years? But I was thinking about this today. Obviously, we live in a democracy, so we vote these people out and they can see it in the polls. So a lot of them leave, not a single pandemic premier left. And they leave and they say, oh, I want to spend more time with my family. No, you're leaving because everyone hates your stinking guts and the polls are reflecting that. But what if we made them stay and sit in the sewers that they've made their states when they shredded their prosperity, when they crushed the human spirit, when they refused, you know, Queensland hospitals are for Queenslanders and all this kind of thing. What if we made them live?
Stay in your house, in your electorate, pay your own power bills.
Actions, instead of swanning off to these kinds of clean energy commissions and raking in hundreds of dollars a year working these jobs. I mean, at least this way is one, like, up for us. It's not on the taxpayer dime anymore, Queenslanders. So that's some win.
That's some plan you've laid out there. Some monologue. It stopped me talking about King Charles and Prince Harry, but I love your idea.
There's no accountability. They just swan on to
Thanks for joining us. Liz Storer and Christy McSweeney, appreciate your time.